My introduction to that tradition came in June of 1964 when I completed my junior year at Harvard College. I'd grown up in Bakersfield, California, where my father was a rabbi and my mother a teacher, and came to school here on a scholarship. But here is where I got involved with people working for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and civil rights work, and volunteered for the Mississippi Summer Project, which was an effort to support the organizing of African-American organizers in that state who were facing jailing, beating, and worse, just for trying to organize people to register to vote. My father had served as a chaplain in the American Army, so we had lived in Germany for 3 years after the Second World War, where a lot of his work, most of his work, was with Holocaust survivors. So as a child, I met people whose lives had been shattered by that horror. But my parents interpreted the Holocaust to me as not being simply about anti-Semitism, but about racism, and racism kills. You turn people into objects and anything can happen. And the civil rights movement was challenging the institutionalized racism that's been foundational to this country since its founding. Now, as a rabbi's kid, I don't know if there's any preacher's kids in the audience or here. Oh, there's one right there. What kind?
Episcopal,
all right, that's pretty good. Yeah, good. I'm sure you'll appreciate what you have to go to all the stuff, you know, you have to show up at it. You're also supposed to be perfect, which is sort of a different set of issues I'm not gonna go into tonight. But I did love the Passover Seder, the story, the telling of the Exodus story with food, which was kind of cool. But there's a place where they would focus on the children and say, you were slaves in Egypt. And I said, what? I've never been a slave, never been to Egypt. It took me a while to figure out what it meant was that that story was not the property of one people, one time, one place. It's told generation after generation. And you have to sort of ask yourself, are you with those guys with the chariots and the horses? Or are you with those people trying to find a way to a land of promise for themselves? Civil rights movement spoke that, told that same story. Dr. King talked of the civil rights movement in terms of yet another chapter in the telling of the Exodus story. And it was a movement of young people. Dr. King, when he led the bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama, was 25. And it makes sense. Walter Brueggemann, a Protestant theologian, wrote a book called The Prophetic Imagination, in which he talks about the fact that transformational vision or prophetic vision occurs at the intersection of two elements. One he calls criticality, which is a clear view of the world's hurt, of its need, of its pain, coupled, he says, with hope, a sense of its promise and its possibility. One without the other is despair or irrelevance. Together, they create the capacity for transformation. And young people come of age with a critical eye on the world they find and almost of necessity hopeful hearts. So for my generation, the civil rights movement was an invitation to enact that kind of vision or that kind of aspiration for change and transformation. Now, with all due respect to Harvard, my education about race, power, and politics began in Mississippi, not in Cambridge. It was evident that all the inequalities between whites and blacks were so evident, housing, healthcare, education, you name it. But it was also clear that bringing a few books or medical supplies wasn't going to, it'd be a nice thing to do. You know, it would be a charitable thing. It wasn't going to change anything. And that's when I began to learn the difference between charity and justice. And the charity says, what's wrong? Let me help. Justice says, why is it happening? Let me change it. That second question is a lot more, that makes people uncomfortable. Because what you tend to discover is that these people are losing over here because there's other, these people that don't have enough over here are because other people over here have too much. And when these people try to change that, these people don't like it. And so then you wind up in a challenge. And it's a challenge about power. And so then the question becomes, since the African-American community in Mississippi had really no practical right to vote, they were excluded from the labor laws that protected other workers in the 30s that left out agricultural workers and domestic workers, which was what most of the work was. I'd never had the experience of going up to someone twice my age who would stand up, offer me his chair, call me mister, introduce himself with his first name, not look me in the eye because he was black and I was white, and that went on thousands of times a day across the South. And you put together the cultural and economic and political powerlessness, and you get some insight into why all the inequality. And it wasn't because people didn't try to change it. They did. There was a lot of resistance, and there was a lot of pushback. So the question became how to get the power to change things. And some people said, well, you go to Washington, D.C., they'll solve it. Hi, Washington, can you give us a little bit of your power? It turned into like, we need more research, more data, testify before our committee. It became evident pretty quickly that unless the people with the problem could also become authors of the solution, it was not going to change. But they don't have any power. We learned there was a difference between resources and power, and that while many communities were lacking power, they were not lacking entirely in resources, and the challenge was how to turn resources into power. The instruction, the school where we learned that, was, everybody know about Rosa Parks? You know, the lady who one day got tired? Yeah, who was secretary of the NAACP chapter, who was trained in organizing at Highlander School, and was part of a strategy to follow up on the Supreme Court ruling about Brown v. Board of Education, allegedly intending to desegregate schools. And it was an effort to file a lawsuit to extend it to transportation, because the buses had blacks in the back, whites in the front, no man's land in the middle, armed deputized bus driver. You had to go past all that, find a seat in the back if you were black, and if a white person needed the seat, then you had to get up and give it to him. Twice a day, going to work, come home from work, a lot of anger in that community. What they discovered was that, in fact, they did have resources. In fact, everybody in that community had resources which could become a source of power. Now, we're used to looking up for power, but what do you see when you look down? What do you see? What do you see? What part of your anatomy do you see? Your feet. It turned out everybody had feet. Now, if they used their feet, instead of using their feet to get on the bus and give the bus company the bus fare, if they used their feet to walk to work instead, and they all did it, then their dependency on the bus company turned into the bus company's dependency on them. And that was the Montgomery bus boycott. And it took a year, and they won. And the significance was that it was an instruction in how to turn resources ordinary people held into sources of power. There were sacrifice involved. There was a lot of solidarity required, but it was transformational. Now, that's what organizing was about how to enable communities to use their resources together to develop the power they needed to change things.